Hello everyone, welcome to Roads to Migrate, initiated by International Refugee Rights Association. This is Gizem Dik, and today we will host Şebinur Doğan for talking about the current situation in Azez, one of the well-known cities in Syria. As the world witnessed, the civil war in Syria destroyed many cities and forced many citizens to seek refuge in another country due to security concerns. Its situation in the current days is quite complicated and worth learning about. Before starting the talk, we would like to briefly introduce today's guest, Şebinur Doğan. She is a senior student of Boğaziçi University in the Department of Economics. Currently, she is doing her internship in the International Refugee Rights Association. Hi, Ms. Doğan. Moving into the questions, firstly, could you tell me about refugee camps in the Turkish borders?
Yeah, sure. We visited a number of refugee camps in the area of Azez. It is not possible to create a uniform profile of refugee camps with exactly the same conditions, actually. Some of the camps we visited were all made up of makeshift tents, some of them containers, and some of them briquette houses, which are more livable, I think. Although it was impossible to live a comfortable life in any of these camps, the situation in the tent camps is much worse. While tent conditions are already difficult, they become even harder in winter because of the freezing cold and rain. Since the camps fill with mud when it rains, it is not even possible to get out of the tent and walk. After seeing how the people in the camps live there, coming to my house and lying in my warm bed made me feel very uncomfortable. Actually, Azez is not the only one. There are many other refugee camp zones on the Syrian border of Turkey, like Idlib, Afrin, Jarablus, and Tel Abyad. All of these regions have a large inflow of refugees and have a very high population. For example, the Atme camp in Idlib, known as the world's largest refugee camp, has a population of over 1.5 million.
So what about the Azez story? Could you give us some background information?
Azez is a city in northwest Syria, on the border of the Turkish province of Kilis, where approximately 100,000 people live. While the region was a district of Aleppo in the classical Syrian map, it has been exposed to various currents, both demographically and militarily, due to the civil war that took place in Syria after 2011. In 2014, the tension in the center of Syria spread to Azez, and many immigrants had to migrate to this region on the Turkish border. Also, the instability and lack of authority in Syria caused foreign fighters to flock to the region. After a while, multilateral conflicts broke out with the military groups already present in the region. Due to these instabilities on the border and the fear that terrorist organizations will dominate the region in the long run, Turkey has created safe zones in certain areas of the Syrian border, and Azez is one of the places where safe zones are established.
Now, I wonder, how did you feel when you visited the area?
Actually, it was a very strange feeling to be on the streets of Syria, in the refugee camps there, which you've seen in photographs for all these years. When you are there and see that war-ravaged city with your own eyes, you realize that the situation is actually beyond what we see in the photographs. When I went there and stepped into a refugee camp for the first time, I saw tents lined up side by side and children playing games and laughing despite everything they've been going through. At that moment, perhaps for the first time, I genuinely realized the reality of this war and how people's lives were taken away from them. It was the children that impressed me the most deeply there. As I looked at the children, I thought that they were born into a war and saw nothing but war throughout their lives. All this was really tragic.
What about humanitarian conditions there? Can you explain as much as possible?
Yeah, sure. I think the conditions in Syria are completely inhumane. People live in tents that are absolutely not cold resistant and can be destroyed by even the slightest rain. In addition to being in urgent need of food, medicine, and basic services, they also have a serious need for clothing. In Syria, even in the middle of winter, you can see little children walking around barefoot or in slippers with thin clothes on them. Considering all this, the lives of the people there depend almost entirely on humanitarian aid. This is extremely sad and frightening, especially considering how sustainable a life that depends on humanitarian aid can be. In addition, the living conditions of women in Syria should also be highlighted, I think. The fact that women have to take care of their children in difficult camp conditions, while also continuing their struggle for life by shouldering all the burden, on the other hand, is very difficult. When you talk to the women there, you see that their biggest dream is to have a wall to lean on. Although a wall to lean on is one of the most basic things in our lives, for women who have spent their lives in tents, this turns into a big dream, unfortunately.
What about humanitarian aid? Is it still going on?
Humanitarian aid in Syria still continues very seriously. There are many different non-governmental organizations that carry out various activities and provide aid there. However, the issue of humanitarian aid is a bit complicated, I think. In situations that last over a very long period of time, as in the case of Syria, humanitarian aid that provides short-term benefits might be inefficient. Obviously, any aid is better than nothing. But in such cases, projects that will provide long-term benefits are definitely needed. As far as I can tell, based on my visit to Azez, such projects are also carried out by various NGOs in Syria. For example, one of the places we visited there was a specially established training center for the visually impaired and those with Down syndrome. It was very impressive to see projects that could provide such long-term benefits are being developed.
Can you please talk about missile attacks to the city centers?
Although Azez is known as one of the safe zones in Syria, the missile attacks are still not completely over, unfortunately. The YPG regularly attacks the Azez region from the south, and this situation creates a constant tension in the region. Many civilians are injured or killed in these attacks. Also, regular bomb and missile attacks create an unsafe environment in the region and lead the people to fear and anxiety. Even during our short visit, we felt the tension of these attacks directly. Especially our team leader experienced great uneasiness during our visit because he followed the latest developments in the region very closely and was very aware of these regular attacks. So we can definitely say that even the safe zones are not as safe as we think they are.
Well, lastly, could you tell me about borders dilemma? Historically, we are so close, but ideologically so far away.
Actually, as Turks and Syrians, we have so many common values and a common historical background. And yet, despite all of these, the point we have reached today seems very strange to me. We have been separated from each other with the phenomenon of nation-state and started treating each other as if we were complete strangers since then. I really cannot understand how a country border can alienate us like this. It makes no sense to me. While we should be brothers and sisters due to our common belief, we now exclude them because of their race. Although we have been so close historically, the fact that we are so far from each other, not physically but mentally, really upsets me.
Thanks for explaining all this. Would you like to add something?
No, Ms. Dik. Thank you very much for hosting me.
Thank you very much for joining us. Dear listeners, this is Gizem Dik and Şebinur Doğan. We have talked about the current situation in Azez. Ms. Doğan shared her experiences in Azez and gave beneficial information about the question of refugee camps, humanitarian conditions, and AIDS, as well as the border dilemma. Thanks for listening. See you next time in Roads to Migrate.